Well, the end of the Colin Baker era. Although it wasn't intended to be so. Hello, Whovians, and welcome to my review of Colin Baker's final story as the Sixth Doctor, which is also the fourth and final segment of Trial of a Time Lord and the end of Season 23. The Ultimate Foe. Once again, thank you to Nicholas Payne for lending me the DVDs. He'll be getting them back soon. The Ultimate Foe. Yeah, this was not intended to be Colin Baker's final story, but due to some issues that were going on at the time, it ended up being his final story. After this season, Colin Baker was basically fired or let go from the role, but more on that later on. The plot of The Ultimate Foe is as follows. The Doctor has tried to prove his innocence, but the Valiard is certain of his guilt and will stop at nothing to carry out a sentence of death. But there is a surprise witness waiting in the wings, one who knows the truth. With the trial in disarray, the Doctor flees into the Matrix to confront his enemy, into a nightmarish world of torture and punishment. Trapped within, he will have to fight for his life against the ultimate foe. There we go, that's the essential premise of this story. So, the ultimate foe, well, this is going to surprise you lot. This really is. I actually enjoyed this story. Yay! Yeah, okay, look, it's not perfect. I don't think the ultimate foe is a masterpiece, but you know what? It'll do. I'll take it. After Terror of the Vervoids, I'll take it. I know it must be disappointing for some of you to know that I haven't enjoyed Trial of a Time Lord so far, but I actually genuinely liked The Ultimate Foe. One thing, it's short, it's two parts long, but this is the first time I feel, and the only time I feel, where the Colin Baker era actually got the tone right. There is a mixture of darkness in there. It is a more serious story. And I especially love the idea of the fantasy factory. I think that is really, really awesome. And I actually think this is Colin Baker's best performance. It's actually nice to know that he does go out on a good story. I think Colin really does give a good final performance. And he proved that he is a good actor. And yeah, again, he's still a bit over the top in places. But in this story, this is where I thought, you know what? This guy actually could have been a great doctor had the circumstances not affected him at the time. That being said, he's still my least favourite doctor, so I can't lie in that respect. I think the story is pretty good, and it basically is the climax of Trial of a Time Lord. We've spent the past three stories building up to this, and I do feel like it is good, but I wish that there were more stakes to this. The fact that they reintroduced the Matrix is great, and I really think that there could have been more made with that. Like, in The Deadly Assassin, there was a massive battle between Tom Baker and the Minion character, and that went on for ages, and the imagination of that was just incredible. The Ultimate Foe does have some of that imagination, and it definitely tries to sort of reinvigorate that kind of imagination, but I do feel the Doctor's confrontation with the Valiard is a little underdone. I think it could have been done slightly better, and I think we could have had a much bigger battle between them. That being said, obviously they didn't know that this was going to be Colin Baker's last story, so had they known that, perhaps they would have made more of an effort to make this more epic. So there are a lack of stakes to the story, but again, they didn't know this was going to be Colin's last story until after the story aired. As for Mel in this story, she only screams once. Once. I'll let her have it. I'll let her get away with it. I do find Mel slightly annoying, but to be fair, in this story, she's actually a bit better than she is in Terror of the Vervoids. I think Bonnie Langford does a good job. I know that the worst of her is yet to come, so believe me. When we get to Sylvester McCoy's era, which will be very soon, I'll definitely have plenty to say about her. But I think she's very good, although I don't see the reason why she's stuck in the trial for so long. Why didn't she just join the Doctor on his mission? It seems like she doesn't really interact with Colin Baker that much in this story. I would have preferred Mel to actually be with the Doctor a bit more. She's kind of basically standing up in trial and trying to explain to the Time Lords, can we turn off the Matrix? You know, something's going wrong. She's there to you know, stand by the Doctor, which is great, and she does do a good job of that, but she spends a bit too long in the trial room, I think. I think the first, a lot of the first part is spent in the trial room, and I think that could have been changed. I think there's a bit too many talky scenes in the story. Even though it's only two parts long, it does feel like they're just talking for quite a long time as well. But that being said, it is far better paced than all of the previous three stories in this season. I think Anthony Ainley is good as the Master. I mean, he's certainly comfortable now with this role. He really is. To begin with, when he began at the end of Tom's era, he was kind of hamming it up, but he has toned it down and he has managed to make his performance a bit better. Roger Delgado, for me, will always be the best Master, but Anthony Ainley is actually pretty good. That being said, I don't see why he's actually in it. It just seems a bit silly to just shoehorn the Master into this already convoluted story. And that's the whole beef with Trial of a Time Lord. I just don't really understand how the Master actually escaped. Like, he was with the Rani when we last saw him at the end of Mark of the Rani, and they were stuck in her TARDIS. So how did he escape the Rani's TARDIS? I don't remember them ever mentioning that, unless I wasn't paying attention. And we do see him in the Matrix, which is interesting. I do feel like they really didn't make enough meat of the Matrix. They really could have used that to their advantage and created something a bit more imaginative. Although there is imagination in this story, but I do think that they kind of, it was a bit of wasted potential with the Matrix. They could have made the Matrix something much bigger and more grander in this story. The whole story should have been set in the Matrix. I would have loved that. I would have loved Trial of a Time Lord to be all set in the Matrix. Maybe it would have got stale if it was a season-long story arc, but perhaps instead of showing all the previous past adventures, have more time in the Matrix. That might have been something interesting. Michael Jason as the Valiard, well, this is clearly his best performance because he gets the most to do. And I think, again, his confrontation with the Doctor is good, but it could be a bit better. It just could be. There could be more stakes to it. Also, the character of Glitz, Tony Selby, they bring him back for some reason. I don't really understand why he comes back. He doesn't really seem to do very much. He was never a character that I really wanted to see come back. So, yeah, he just feels kind of unnecessary to the whole thing, really. Luckily for this story, the cheapness doesn't look as bad. And like I said, when we get to the fantasy factory, it's all dark. It's in a dark, abandoned sort of village. It looks really kind of atmospheric and almost, dare I say it, kind of scary. And I think more scenes like that would have been crucial. There's even a scene when the Doctor is being grabbed by the legs and the arms and he's being pulled into the mud, which is a fairly intense scene, actually. So I was quite impressed with the way that they actually managed to create some more tension. If the Colin Baker era was like this, and I got the tone right like this, then maybe Colin's era would have worked out much differently. I know the show was criticised at the end of Davison's era for being too dark, but this wasn't too dark. This was just the right amount of dark you needed, and I think there was a decent amount of light relief as well. Obviously more on the side of Colin Baker and Mel. So I really think if Colin did a third season, maybe if the tone was like this, they probably could have worked with that and made it his best season. It's just a shame that the whole Trial of a Time Lord story, to me, is just incredibly convoluted. Although this particular segment in itself is a good climax to all that. I mean, you can't really watch The Ultimate Foe without watching the previous three parts anyway. But it's the best one. It's the best one simply for what it wraps up. I wouldn't say it wraps it up in a nice, neat package, but it wraps it up well enough. I mean, it doesn't obviously... I mean, the whole story is convoluted anyway, but it makes the best of a bad story, as far as I'm concerned. And on its own, it actually stands pretty well, too. And the script by Pip and Jane Baker is actually not too bad. It's not anything amazing, but it's not terrible either. I think this could potentially be their best script. I mean, well, who knows? But as for Colin's last story, I mean, it could have been a worse exit. There could have been a much worse exit. Now, we come to the rating. My rating for The Ultimate Foe, this is going to surprise you. This is going to surprise you, people. I'm going to give this story an 8 out of 10. Yeah, you didn't see that coming, did you? So, yes, by all accounts, look at my ratings for the other stories of Colin Baker. This is now my favourite Colin Baker story. Yay! They saved the best till last. And they had the worst first with The Twin Dilemma. So, yeah, let's get on to the mini-ranking. I know that technically Trial of a Time Lord is one story, but just for the hell of it, let's do the mini ranking anyway. It's the end of season 23, Colin's second and final season. So, at number 4, has to be Terror of the Vervoids. Number 3 would probably have to be The Mysterious Planet. Number 2, Mind Warp. And of course, number 1, The Ultimate Foe. And that's it, folks. That is the end of the Colin Baker era. Woo! Okay, look, I can't deny that Colin Baker is not my favourite Doctor. He is probably my least favourite Doctor. But I do appreciate his contribution to the show, and I do feel sorry for him, because he was saddled with some very bad scripts and some unfortunate circumstances during the time of both the seasons, actually. Like, after his first season, the show went on a hiatus for a year and a half, so times were not very good. So Colin and everyone else really had to do something with season 23 to get the people interested again, and sadly, Trial of a Time Lord just didn't grab people, and it was clear that Colin Baker's Doctor just wasn't very popular. He just wasn't connecting with the public, and very unfortunately, he was fired. Or let go. Choose whichever term you want to describe it. And I do feel sorry for him. I don't think he deserved that. I mean, as much as I don't like him in the role, I do appreciate some aspects of what he tried to do. I know that he was trying to evolve his Doctor. His Doctor was kind of Hartnell-esque in the beginning, and he was grumpy and aggressive, and he was going to evolve into a much nicer guy, but it just seems like because of the bad scripts, they never seemed to involve his Doctor, and Colin was never allowed to play this role in the way he wanted to, which I really feel sorry for. But I think letting him go without doing a regeneration story was a real shame. Even if Colin came back for one more story after this just to do a regeneration, that would have been fine. He didn't even come back in time of the Rani to film a regeneration scene, so this is the last time we'll ever see Colin in the show, which is a shame. But of course, he will return in audio form with Big Finish, which I've heard about. I've not listened to it, but I've heard about a lot of that stuff. But yeah, it's sad that Colin's last story wasn't intended to be his last, and he was let go from the role, which is sad. He didn't deserve that. He really didn't. But the show would carry on for 3 more years before it got axed with Sylvester McCoy. So we will be talking about Sylvester McCoy in the next review with Time and the Rani. Oh dear, it's going to be fun. Just to say off the bat, to any fans of Colin Baker, I'm sorry if my reviews have been negative, but I'm just being totally honest when I say I'm not really a fan of his era. And to be fair, his era is very short, so it's short, it's sweet, it's only 2 seasons long. I like 2 stories. I like The Ultimate Foe and I like Vengeance on Varos. So every Doctor for me has at least 1 or 2 good stories. No Doctor has ever had completely bad eras all the way through. So if that makes you feel better, that's my opinion. I can't deny Colin's era is not an era I'd like to revisit anytime soon, but I will, you know, raise a toast and say, Colin Baker, thank you very much for playing the Doctor. It's a shame it didn't work out the way you wanted to, but I appreciate your contribution nonetheless. Cheers. And with that in mind, that's it. That's my review of The Ultimate Foe. So thank you all very much for watching, and stay tuned next time when I review The Time and the Rani, where we go into Sylvester McCoy's era, the 7th Doctor. We haven't got much of the classic era left, so this should be interesting. And yeah, what do you think of The Ultimate Foe? Please comment down below, let me know. Please leave your ranking of season 23 down below. I'd really love to know what you think. So in terms of Trial of a Time Lord, overall, just to be a completist, this technically constitutes as Colin's final story, all 4 of these segments. So out of 40, my rating for this is unfortunately going to be 15 out of 40. Yeah, adding all the scores up, it just made it over double figures mark, but it's not very good. That's a very low score, 15 out of 40. That's not very good at all. But anyway, enough of that. Let's not end this on a downer. To Colin Baker, and his amazing Technicolor dream coat. So, until next time, I'm Mr. TARDIS 11. See you soon. Bye for now.